Good morning and welcome back. I'm Jim Derryberry and it's good to be back starting on Marvin Methodist Church's new normal. We would like to wish happy birthdays this week to Tina Boone, Margie Cooperland, Jeff Main, and myself. I will turn 40 this year. And happy anniversary this week to
Lion in the Church House,
Bradley and Ashley Albright. Just a few things to call to your attention. Our charge conference day has been set for Wednesday, November 4th, and we will be talking about this closer to that day, more about this closer to that day. We will continue to wear masks during our worship time together and social distance. We ask that everybody be respectful of those around you and be aware of their personal space. We want everybody to be comfortable with coming back together as an active church with members present. We want to make it clear to everyone that our regular hymn singing will be done by our praise team. You are welcome to sing and or follow along silently. Our Marvin and Motion exercise class has started back with a new schedule. They meet Monday and Wednesday from 9:30 to 11 a.m. in the gym. And at this time, we are open to our members and regular attendees only. 4-H starts back this week, Wednesday night at 6 o'clock in the gym. Our youth are back on track for youth. Open gym prayer night that takes place on the first and third Wednesday of each month from 6 to 7. An email was sent out this past week to let Sunday school teachers know that Sunday school can resume at the teacher's discretion. You'll receive news that some classes are opting to wait a bit longer before regular classes, while a few others have chosen to start back up each Sunday at 9:45. A candy donation box has been placed in the fellowship hall. It will be used to hand out to our kids and friends on Saturday, October 31st. And please donate individually wrapped candy only. Are there any other announcements to be made? Now let us quiet our hearts as we prepare for worship, and may the Lord be with you.
Thank you. continue with the rest of What Friend We Have in Jesus. Okay, today the Psalter is Psalm 91, and it is in your bulletin. Those who dwell in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord,
my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust.
For the Lord will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence, and will cover you with his pinions.
Under the Lord's wings you will find refuge. God's faithfulness is a shield and a buckler.
You will not fear the terror of the night, nor will the arrow that flies by day.
Nor the pestilence that stalks in darkness, nor the destruction that wastes at noonday.
1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you.
You will only look with your eyes and see the recompense of the wicked.
Because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your habitation,
no evil shall befall you, no scourge shall come near your tent.
For God will give you his angels charge over you to guard you in all our ways.
They will bear you up on your hands, lest you dash your foot against the stone. You will tread on the lion and the adder. The young lion and the serpent will trample underfoot.
Because they cleave to me in love, I will deliver them.
I will protect them because they know my name.
When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them.
I will satisfy them with long life and show them my salvation.
That we social distance. And when we came into this building, everybody pretty much sat in their traditional seats. And, you know, it's kind of like when they say we're going to fill the they won't let but 25% come into the football stadium. Well, all that 25% is gathered at the 50-yard line, and that's not social distancing. So now I size you a little bit and say, when we gather, we need to really practice this. This is serious stuff. So maybe give up your traditional seat for a little bit and find someplace else to sit. Also, the choir is open. And so please take care of yourself and take care of each other as we do this. We're trying this, and we want to be safe as we do this. So what a privilege it is to gather in God's holy name. We invite you to come to the altar. And if you want to spend some time at the altar in prayer, you're welcome to do that. At this time, we invite you to come with God's tithes and our offerings. Gracious Lord, thank you for all the blessings that you have given us. Strengthen us in all that we are. You've given us the power of thought, of creation, of talent. And Lord, as we come before you, we ask that you bless the gifts and the givers in Christ's holy name. Amen.
Mary, would you please come get this and put it up there while I play the game?
Thank you.
confession of the Christian faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From hence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you. Please do this. Before we enter into time of prayer, and we're praying for each other and praying for our leadership and the decision to kind of come back to kind of some old ways of normal. About Sunday school, we are allowing each Sunday school class to make their own decision about whether they feel comfortable gathering or not. And if you don't feel comfortable gathering in the space that you're providing, you want to move to the gym or spread out or something like that, we're willing to accommodate. And so we, again, want to affirm everybody's decision. If you choose not to come, that's fine. We respect that. Please continue to stay connected to the church in the variety of ways that we can. We love you and we miss you. Also, that there are devices to take temperature that are in the doorways, and we encourage you that if there's nobody there, because sometimes there are, sometimes there's not. Missy usually takes the temperature, and she's on vacation this week. We affirm Missy taking care of herself. She's been taking care of others for a long time, so she needs some self-care. Take your own temperature. Can we be adult about this without having somebody to tell us the social distance? Or, you know, can we be respectful of one another that way? We are hoping that we are a mature enough church where we can respect one another, where we can do the things that we know that we should do. And as long as we can do that, and if we can keep this virus down, we'll continue on this path. But if we can't do that, we're going to have to go back to some other way. And Dawn's going to have to tell us how to sit. So let's do that. Amen? All right. Keep us in your prayers as we make the best decisions that we can. Prayerfully, Southwest Louisiana's got hit again. I don't know if anybody's got family and friends down there, but... I've already heard some reports from UMCOR as far as ways to go out. All those blue tarps that we put up, they're blown off. So, got to come and redo them, and some of those houses that have already been gutted got more water in them. It's a tough thing, you know, and so keep those in thoughts, minds, and prayers. Pray for our country. Pray for our process of election. It is a beautiful thing that we have. It's not perfect, but when we think about countries across the world and how they change leadership, sometimes in coup d'etats, we are blessed. Participate in the process. Let's pray for one another and as we abide in this. Continue to pray for each other concerning COVID. I went back to a former church last night to do their charge conference. And, you know, it's one of those things, you want a hug on folks? But we couldn't do that. And I learned that two former church members have died of this disease. And it hurt my heart. Lisa Hedrick, whose husband we've talked about and prayed for because he had breast cancer. Yes, men get breast cancer. And then her sister, Lynn Sorey, who is the wife of the Honorable Stan Sorey, who's a judge in Raleigh. Passed away, and their son John was Ian's age. Ian spent the night in their house. This disease is real, and why it affects some and not others, we still don't completely understand. Keep us all in your prayers. Who else are we praying for? I get up here and ramble and I forget. Help me.
Phoebe Nichols, Jason's wife, her grandmother Janice has been diagnosed with breast cancer.
Okay. So Phoebe's grandmother, Phoebe Quinn, teacher of the year, praying for her grandmother. Who else? Continue to pray for our nurses, those on the front lines, our first responders. Let's pray for our church. Let's pray for each other. As we unite our hearts, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Gracious God, faithfully we come before you. We come before you with our hearts, with our minds, with our hands open, ready to receive the power of your Holy Spirit, the gifts of your wisdom, the courage of your heart. Strengthen us, Lord, that we may be your church. And as we seek to grow disciples and be an instrument of transformation in this world, that it may be the kingdom of heaven on earth. Lord, we pray that you forgive us for anything that we've done or anything that we've left undone, that have gotten in the way of our relationship with you or have stood in the way of our relationship with each other. Thank you, Lord, for the cleansing power of your holy blood, that as we look to the cross, we realize that we are made new in your presence. And then in that newness, Lord, we may take courage to move forward and to try again. Help us, Lord, to continue to be your church so that you may be our God and we may be your people. For all that we hold in our heart and all that we've already prayed for, we lift it up for your holy touch. For when we can't do anything else, Lord, we pray in the way that you taught us when you said, say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever and ever. Amen. Our hymn is printed in your insert, I Need Thee Every Hour, verses 1, 2, 4, and 5. We need Jesus. I invite you to, you may remain seated as we sing.
Thank you.
provide some crayons and some things down here up front. If we got some little ones that want them, come on up and get them. I'm just going to put them up front. You just come get them as you need. How about that? Or maybe they can be passed out. And when you take the bag, you keep it. It's yours. We don't want it back. So, I'm reading from Luke chapter 4. We got some adults who want some crayons too. I'm reading from Luke chapter 4, verses 1 through 13, as it's printed in your bulletin if you want to read with me. The story of Jesus' temptation in the wilderness. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing, and during those days and at the end of them, he was hungry. Now the devil said to him, "If you're the Son of the Man, tell this stone to become bread." Jesus answered, as we read in Psalm 91, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." And Jesus said, "It is written that man shall not live on bread alone." The devil led him up on a high place and showed him in an instant the kingdoms of the world. And he said to them, "I will give you all the authority and splendor that has been given to me. And I can give it to anyone I want to. If you worship me, it will be all yours." Jesus answered, "It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." And the devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand in the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here. For it is written, he will command his angels concerning you to guard you carefully, and they will lift you up on their hands." Jesus answered, "It is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test." And when the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. Beloved, it's the word of God for the people of God, as the people say. Thanks be to God. Lord God, we need you every hour because there's always an opportune time to be tempted. Open our hearts and our minds up to the power of your holy word that we may know your presence among us. In Christ's holy name, amen. Well, I wanted to talk this morning about temptation, and I wanted to talk about evil, and I wanted to talk about Satan. You know, lively, happy things. I don't usually talk about that aspect of stuff. It's not that I don't believe in it, but I really want the sermon message to be more uplifting and happy. But we have to talk about the realities and struggles of our spiritual world, because I want you to know I do believe in evil. And I do believe that evil moves among us, and evil tempts us. Tempts me, even. And I think if we don't acknowledge it, then we can't guard against it. And so there is a discipline of at least recognizing what's going on with you in the midst of temptations and the process of evil around us. And I thought I would look at this scripture specifically to see what was going on and what was going on with Jesus as he resisted these temptations. I think one of the things we first of all need to realize is that Jesus was led out into a wilderness. And what is a wilderness anyhow? From a first century perspective, a wilderness is kind of a place where God's sort of abandoned. There's no growth. There's no life. There's no joy. There's no hope. It's just rocks. There's no rain. It's just dirt. And when you're out there, you kind of find yourself needy, don't you? You find yourself wanting. You find yourself hungry. And Jesus is out there participating in a discipline of fasting. This is a spiritual act. He is denying himself physical need to grow spiritually. Hopefully we practice this maybe in the season of Lent as we prepare for Easter. We're encouraged to look at the physical natures so that we can grow in the spiritual ones. This is what Jesus is doing. And so when you're hungry, you get those temptations. Y'all know the temptations. Come home about 3 o'clock, and you think, I should eat an apple, maybe a banana. That bag of cookies really looks good. So the words speak to us. You know, I've talked a lot about God speaking to us, especially from the John 10 passage about the shepherd know the sheep by the shepherd's voice, about how we need to walk with God so that we know God's voice. And it's important that we hear God's voice in the midst of temptations, because there's a lot of things out there that are talking to us. I'm going to put it this way. There's a lot of things out there right now that are screaming at us. All you got to do is turn on the TV, and you hear with it, we need to think this or believe that or have this political view or have that political view. And people are demonizing one another. It's like, unless you're totally this way, you're completely wrong. Unless you're totally with me, you must be totally against me. And in that sense, we're pushing each other further and further and further away. And this is not what the kingdom of God is about. We have to hear a voice that unites us, that helps us to find common ground. Because God says, you know, you're hungry. Come, eat. Take that physical pleasure. I think growing up, we all kind of grew up in a place where we learned about good and bad, didn't we? We all kind of grew up in something where somebody told us what was right, something was wrong. Some of us didn't have that blessing. I grew up every morning, and on Sundays we'd listen to the gospel singing Jubilee. It was a Christian household, four square gospel singing. We'd have donuts, and we'd go to church. My mom would teach Sunday school. My dad would teach Sunday school. My mom would lead a choir. And it was a Christian. That was my experience of growing up. And we would watch the new Christian Broadcasting Network on TV with Pat Robertson. And Pat Robertson would tell us about all the evils in the world. And they would have, at the time, it was book burnings and record burnings. Y'all ever hear about record burnings? What kind of records did we burn? Y'all remember? Come on.
Rock and roll.
Rock and roll records. Woo! Lots of evil there.
Ozzy Osbourne.
Def Leppard. AC/DC. Alice Cooper. Surely, these are the things that are evil. But when we see on TV, we have the things that are good. You know, Jerry Falwell, Jimmy Lee Swagger, Jimmy Tammy Faye Baker. These are the examples of goodness, at least from the early and late 70s. And now, where we sit from the year 2000 and we look back, I heard an interview with Alice Cooper. He's actually a really intelligent, well-written, well-spoken historian. Who would have thought? And then we see that, in fact, those televangelists, they're really human. And they have their faults, just like everybody else. And now, Franklin Graham on top of that. Maybe we're all just human. Maybe we all have our good points, our strong points, but also our failures. Maybe it's not good and bad, right and wrong. Maybe it's all of us trying to figure it out. And as we try and figure it out, we have to somehow hold each other accountable in the kingdom of God and say, yes, this is a child of God as I am. We don't always have to agree with everybody's choice in life. We don't have to agree with people's lifestyles, but we do have to respect that they are children of God just as we are, and that Christ died for them as we did, as he did for me and you also. And so as we do that, we realize there are things that come to us, there are things that speak to us, there are things that tempt us and lead us astray, and the Satan doesn't always look like Ozzy Osbourne. But in fact, Satan comes to us and saying, here's some bread. Take and eat. And so Desi, in her cooking class, has made sourdough bread. And in her loving kindness, she shared some of her classwork with me. Now, don't I look like I need some sugar carbohydrates? My point is, God doesn't always look like Def Leppard or AC/DC. Sometimes God, or the Satan, looks more like Desi Barlow. Temptations abound. We have to hear God's word in the midst. Satan also tempted God, or tempted Jesus, by telling him he came up and he looked at all these kingdoms. If he just bowed down, all those kingdoms would be his. Now, don't we want to at least be king or queen of our own kingdom, of our own household, of our own world? Don't we want to sit in our own pew at church, not give up any of that power? We don't want anybody telling us what to do, when to wear a mask, when not to wear a mask. We want to be in control. I remind you that the original temptation, the original sin, as the serpent invited Adam and Eve, says, eat of this and you will what? Be as God. So, in the midst of all the coronavirus and the social struggles of racial inequality and the political pressures of the election that's coming up, don't we want to be in control of this? Don't we want to have some say in our own lives? Don't we want to not feel like we're out of control? And it's easy to say, I want to at least be in control of my own kingdom and not have anybody else tell me what to do. Now, Satan doesn't come to us like somebody that wants to stand in our face and say, you're not in control of your own kingdom. Satan, first of all, comes to us in a time of hurt. Now, think about this. We get hurt all the time. We get hurt emotionally. Sometimes we get hurt physically, but most of the time, it's about our pride. It's about emotions. It's about, you know, somebody got in the way of who we are. Somebody sat in our pew. How dare they? Things happen all the time. If we are going to be together in this world, we're going to make mistakes. We're going to step on each other's feet. And one thing that I've learned by being a band parent and working in the concession stand is there's no way to get in there and work without bumping into one another, dropping stuff, spilling stuff. And you know what? We try and stay focused on the kids, and we try and be forgiving constantly. Always. That's the way the church should be. If we're going to work together, we're going to get in each other's hair, and we're going to make each other upset. And so we first of all feel that hurt. We feel that sting. We feel that pain. And in the midst of that, we get mad. And as we get mad, you may not even think about this process, but it's true when you sit down and think, we get mad, and as we get mad, we begin to feel justified in our anger. I can't tell you how many people have come to me and quoted the scripture about how Jesus overturned the tables in the temple and said, I had justified anger. My anger was righteous because I was right and everybody else was wrong. Don't we want to feel like we're in control of our kingdom? A lot of times it's policies. It's not even personal. It's not personal. It's never been personal. It might be policies and procedures. Just about every daycare or child care program out there has a policy about biting. If your kid tends to bite or tends to hit, your kid goes home. Now, why is that? Because we need to have a policy to protect all children. And if, unfortunately, if your kid has to be pulled out, then maybe we'll try and help. Find some program, find something to teach the child that the child doesn't have to act out by biting and by hitting. And you know what? The church has policies too. I can't tell you how many times as a pastor I've had to talk to a parent, I'm sorry, but we're going to have to send little Jamie home until because she bit another kid in the daycare. Now, you would think a reasonable parent would say, my gosh, I'm so sorry. I'm sorry that that child got bit. We're going to have to apologize. And I'm going to do everything I can do to help my little child grow out of this. Isn't this the right thing that happens? What do you really get? Oh, my precious darling would never bite anybody. And then in some aspect of righteous anger, the next thing you know, they shut themselves off from the church and from anybody else and take their dolls and go home. It hurts my heart. It hurts my heart to see people leave, but as we, the leadership of the church, has to protect all the church, sometimes we have to focus on one and say, we have to make some adjustments. It's not personal. Don't take it personal. Think about the greater kingdom, the kingdom of God that is out there that we are not in control of. And we can lay that temptation down. The last temptation that y'all like to see here, I'm wrapping it up. Was the temptation was to throw yourself down. The scripture says that angels would lift us up. And we read from 91 that even if we fall, angels would protect us. But Satan tells him to throw yourself off the temple. Now, there's a lot of different ways to interpret this scripture, and one of the ways to interpret this is more of kind of a suicidal leap. Go ahead and give up. Just quit altogether. Just stop participating in anything, and God will take care of it. Yeah, we could kind of quit social distancing. We could just go out and flood the streets with coronavirus. And how many people would we lose in the midst of that? We could quit. It'd be nice. It'd be nice to give up and just throw the mask away and do what we want to do all the time. And that is tempting. But it's not what we need to do. It's not what's good for the majority of us. And we have to think beyond ourselves. I think also that in the midst of this, a lot of people have used the coronavirus as an attempt. We're just going to quit church altogether. We're not going to participate in any kind of ministry. We're not going to participate in any kind of connection. We're not going to participate in any kind of faith. I'm just going to stay at home. And that's not right either. The thing about temptations is that temptations always want to talk to you and say, you don't need God. And you don't need each other. But from the very beginning of creation, as God created Adam and Eve and put them in the Garden of Eden, we needed God for everything. And God created everything. And everything that we say and do is about our devotion and our life in God's great kingdom. And inasmuch as we left that garden, it now is about what Christ has done for us. And it's not about how good or how great or how perfect or how imperfect we are. It's about forgiveness, and it's about love. And it has been for 2,000 years if we dare to call ourselves baptized children of Christ. Temptations abound every day. But we have to remember who we are as the church and who we are in the kingdom of God. Temptations come to us in crazy ways, not always in obvious ways. Temptations come to us and usually speak time of hurt and say, you know, you were right, and you should get back at him, get that vengeance thing going. Temptations also tell us to quit, but we don't. Jesus didn't quit on us, and we don't need to quit on each other. This church will continue. Continue to take care of yourselves. Continue to believe in this virus and social distance. Continue to support cops and also recognize that we need to support Black Lives Do Matter. Continue to participate in the life of the church. Continue to participate in the election process. Don't quit! Don't quit on you. Don't quit on me. And don't quit on God. Defend that temptation. Amen. Gracious God, thank you that you didn't quit on us. And even though things around us want to lead us astray, help us to stay connected with you and connected with each other. And even in this wilderness of corona and social problems and election, we know that you are there. Thank you, Lord, for being there for us. In Christ's holy name, amen. Our closing hymn is "It Is Well With My Soul." Horatio Nelson entered a wilderness period after hearing about the death of his wife and children. He penned these words. I invite you to stand as we sing our closing hymn. Oh, As you leave, you're invited to go out any door you choose. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. Let all God's children say, amen.